Nick, tell me about the background of the International Space Apps Challenge. Where did this idea come from?
So the International Space Apps Challenge grew out of our involvement with the Random Hacks of Kindness project, which was a collaboration with Microsoft, Google, Yahoo, HP, and World Bank. And the idea of that was we wanted to change the world through mass collaboration and engage people in solving real challenges that matter to organizations. And we came up with the idea of International Space Apps Challenge by applying that model to NASA. And the ultimate goal was to engage citizens around the world in helping solve grand challenges that NASA offers.
It's not anybody in particular, any group of people. Everybody?
Yeah, we're not prescriptive in anyone's title or talent or whatever they have on the resume. If they have a passion for space exploration, we want to engage them.
The first of these activities took place last year. How did it go?
Yeah, we had the first one almost exactly a year ago in April. It went really well. It exceeded our expectations at the time. We had 25 cities around the world and 2,083 participants, and 101 solutions were developed in 48 hours. We thought that we were really on to something at the time.
That many solutions, you say, were developed. How many of them turned out to be something that were very worthwhile and useful?
You know, we were actually surprised by this. A very large majority of them, like 80% of them, were actually useful solutions after the fact.
This year you set out 50 different challenges for people to try to solve, including some that were directly applicable to the International Space Station. Give us a few examples.
Yeah, so this year, just to clarify, this year we actually had a lot more participants in our event this year too. So we had about 9,000 people participate this year, and the event actually took place in 83 cities around the world in 44 countries. So all seven continents, and we had a space station involved with a pre-recorded message. And so we offered 58 challenges actually totally. And there were a number of solutions that came out of them. One of them, directly applicable to a space station, was a challenge called Spot the Station. And we had over 35 or about 35 entries to this one challenge alone. And one of the solutions that came out of it was a software hardware application that both allows a user to follow the space station using augmented reality in an iPhone app, and then it takes that data and augments it with hardware that lights up when space station is nearby.
Okay, that's one.
Yeah, and so there's a few others, obviously many related to space exploration. We had one that I'm just really particularly excited about. It was called Wish You Were Here, was the challenge name. And the idea was to help citizens connect with our Mars mission that's happening right now. We have a lot of data from Mars exploration programs, but how can we actually make that more tangible to the user? So what they developed was a solution called SOL. It's the first interplanetary weather system for your iPhone. And the idea is that you can see the weather on Mars, and you can compare that with your weather on Earth. And it's a really just ingenious app that's actually going to be on the App Store this week.
You probably feel better about yourself, too, because you have better weather than Mars, right?
That's definitely true. That's definitely true.
Okay, space station, Mars.
And then we had a number of other ones. One of them really looked at the corona activity on the sun and allowed you to understand when that was at a high level or when it was at a low level, because we're constantly being bombarded on Earth with this activity, but oftentimes we don't have any idea of what's actually happening. And so this was something you could just hang on your wall and it would light up when there was activity going on.
Now you mentioned was it 83 countries?
83 cities, 44 countries.
44 countries all over the world. And we brought a couple of photographs to show you what it looked like when it went on. Describe what we're seeing here, the brochure?
Yeah, so this is just a brochure that actually a lot of the participants were given that just described the challenges ahead of time. The participants would have a chance to look at all the challenges before the weekend started and really pick the ones that they gravitated towards. And then the weekend of the event, they actually chose one to work on.
And the second picture gives you kind of an example in this location anyway of the people who are there.
Yeah, this is a picture from Philadelphia, which was our global main stage. And this is the reception on Friday night, where all the participants came together. It was part of Philly Tech Week, actually. And it was a huge event where there's a number of speakers, including Leland Melvin, who just were excited about space exploration. We're talking to the participants about the future of NASA.
You mentioned a moment ago to me, too, that you were surprised that quite a lot of the people that you had turn out, there were a lot more women than you expected.
Yeah, we have a really interesting case this year that we had a very large amount of participation from women. Usually in the tech industry, when you do something like this, you have a lower, and just STEM in general, you have a lower population of women that participate. In New York City, half of the 175 participants were women. It's incredible.
So you've got these all these people that are turning out, and they put up some of their own signage, actually, that to show you where to go.
Yes.
But these are the people that turned out, right? These are our computer geeks.
Yeah. Well, and what's great about this event is it's not only developers, it's also technologists, entrepreneurs, designers, programmers. So this is a great example of what the creativity that comes out of this weekend.
And we've got a couple of looks inside the room of the people at work.
Yeah, they're hard at work.
Drawing on the wall.
You know, it's interesting. We will offer them food at lunchtime, and they won't even want to stop working. They just work right through the weekend.
And this one, you said, was actually one of your favorites.
Yeah, this is one of my favorite photos from events like this from all time. Because what you see here is the men are in minority in this picture. Mm-hmm. And the women just look like they're really having a great time.
This International Space App Challenge happened this past weekend.
That's correct.
Way yet for people to be involved in it?
Yeah, we actually, so we had 770 solutions submitted for the judging process, which is incredible. It's overwhelming. And so we've down selected those to about the top 100, and we're going to have a People's Choice Award. And what we're asking people to do is go online and vote for your favorite solution. We're then going to down select from those into the top 15 or so, and we're going to have a second round of that competition. We're going to choose one overall winner based on popular vote.
From all of the different areas, all of the 58 different challenges, as well as, I guess, a winner in each area?
Yeah, we're going to have, in addition to that one winner, we will have four additional winners, one for best use of data, one for best use of hardware, one for galactic impact, and then one for most inspiring.
And it sounds like some or more of these are going to be available for anybody to use.
Yeah, the great thing about this event is that every solution that was submitted, all 770 of them, are submitted under an open source license, meaning that NASA can use the code or anybody can use the code. And a lot of them, you'll find them on the app stores, Android, iPhone. A lot of them are web-based browser tools, and some of them are hardware that you can download the plans, build yourself a CubeSat based on their plans, and go forward. Mm-hmm.
Obviously, this is tying in with NASA's overall effort at education and outreach and getting more people involved.
Yeah, and it's not just education outreach. What we tried to do was develop an event here that we could educate the public about what space exploration is all about and what we're doing and the missions and the programs that we have. But more than that, we are trying to aggregate useful contributions to the space program. There's a lot of people outside of NASA who love what we do, but have never had an opportunity to actually participate firsthand. They don't have a job here. They're not an astronaut. They can't fly in space. So, but they have great, brilliant ideas. And so what we've done here is provide a way for people to actually contribute. And our goal is to actually pull a large amount of these solutions back into the space agency.
It looked like you had a lot of fun there, and you're going to have some good results.
Yeah, it's incredible. I live for these events. They are so inspiring to see people from around the world, ages 8 to 75, participating in an event like this.
Nick, I appreciate it. Thank you for bringing us up to date on it. Nick Skytland is the program manager for NASA's Open Innovations Program.